Polls show President Joe Biden trails Donald Trump in 5 of the 6 most important battleground states exactly a year before the U.S. election. That says Americans express doubts on Biden's age and dissatisfaction toward his handling of the economy. According to findings from the New York Times and Siena College polls, the Republican frontrunner leads in Arizona, Georgia, Michigan, Nevada, and Pennsylvania, while Biden is ahead in Wisconsin. Biden defeated Trump in all 6 states in 2020, but Trump now leads by an average of 40% in 5. Additional findings showed if Trump were to be convicted in criminal charges against him, support in some swing states could erode by 6%. Former U.S. President Donald Trump complaining of unfair treatment in his rambling testimony at a civil fraud trial in New York. Under questioning about the Trump Organization's accounting practices, Trump got on the wrong side of Judge Arthur Engoron, who is weighing the imposition of hundreds of millions of dollars in fines and other penalties. Trump was warned he would be removed from the witness stand if he did not answer directions, make that answer questions directly.
See what a scam this is. This is a case that should have never been brought. It's a case that should be dismissed immediately. The fraud was on behalf of the court. The court was the fraudster in this case. They made references to assets that were very valuable, and they said they had no idea. They had no idea what the numbers were when they said $18 million for Mar-a-Lago, and it's 50 to 100 times that amount by any estimation. It's a terrible thing that's happened here. We're taking days and days and weeks, and it goes on.
Trump's testimony wrapped up mid-afternoon. All eyes now turn to his daughter, Ivanka, who is set to testify Wednesday. Possible relief amid the intense fighting in the Gaza Strip. U.S. President Joe Biden and Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu have discussed tactical pauses in the Israeli military's operations in the enclave. The White House says this would provide civilians with opportunities to evacuate, ensure the delivery of aid, and enable potential hostage releases.
I know the Biden administration has also said now is not the time for a ceasefire. What they're proposing is a humanitarian pause. There will be no pause?
Well, there'll be no ceasefire, general ceasefire in Gaza without the release of our hostages. As far as tactical little pauses, an hour here, an hour there, we've had them before. I suppose we'll check the circumstances in order to enable goods, humanitarian goods to come in, or our hostages, individual hostages to leave. But I don't think there's going to be a general ceasefire. It's not that I don't think. I think it will hamper the war effort. It'll hamper our effort to get our hostages out, because the only thing that works on these criminals in Hamas is the military pressure that we're exerting.
A harrowing milestone in the besieged Gaza Strip. The death toll there has surpassed the 10,000 mark since Israel began bombings 1 month ago. The Israel military continues to hit refugee camps, mosques, and even hospitals, claiming to be targeting Hamas tunnels. Out of the 10,000 dead, over 4,000 are children. The United Nations chief now calling Gaza a graveyard for children.
Hundreds of girls and boys are reportedly being killed or injured every day. More journalists have reportedly been killed over a 4-week period than in any conflict in at least 3 decades. More United Nations aid workers have been killed than in any comparable period in the history of our organization. We must act now to find a way out of this brutal, awful, agonizing dead end of destruction, to help end the pain and suffering, to help heal the broken, and to help pave the way to peace, to a two-state solution with Israelis and Palestinians living in peace and security.
As the war marks its first month, families of hostages being held by Hamas are ramping up pressure on the Israeli government for their release. More in this report.
A crowd in Tel Aviv, Israel, rallying in support of the Israelis and others held hostage by Hamas for a month now, chants in Hebrew, Achshav, Achshav, meaning now, now.
every moment that Inbal and all the other are there, it's risking their life, and all the airstrikes and the ground invasion is really risking their lives, so we cannot wait anymore. We are expecting from our politicians to do everything to bring them home now, to pay any price.
Noam Alon, whose girlfriend Inbar Hyman was kidnapped October 7 from the Supernova Music Festival in South Israel, says that after protesting almost daily for the past month, he is sleeping in a tent in front of the Israel Defense Forces headquarters in Tel Aviv, along with other people whose loved ones were abducted to Gaza.
We are fighting to get them back. We are begging on any platform, anyone with influence, just to get them back. They are innocent people who did nothing wrong, old people who need their medications. I can't even imagine where they are or what is being done to them.
4 weeks have passed, with Hamas still holding about 240 hostages in Gaza. Their families decided to ramp up the pressure on the Israeli government to make sure their release is top priority. Families are frustrated not only with the government, but also with the world, which they feel cares mainly about humanitarian access to Gaza civilians. Lisa Shpalansky speaks of her 19-year-old cousin Karin Ariev.
And we saw a video of her being kidnapped by Hamas. She was with two other girls inside a jeep. We saw that she was hurt in the face. And other than that, we don't know anything. Nobody tells us because nobody knows. Hamas doesn't release any information about whether they're fine.
She says the Israeli Defense Forces gives 200% to bring the hostages back, but the world needs to do more.
They're hypocrites when they call us out for trying to get back our families, but if it were their family, wouldn't they move heaven and earth for them?
Israeli artist Hila Galili has built several installations calling attention to the hostages. She says her work reflects the impossible situation of their families.
Hostages' families are in a situation where they can't talk because of the fear of retaliation against their loved ones. The hostages also can't raise their voices because they're locked up and they're tied up. So I'm standing like this, and sometimes when you're standing silent, the scream is much louder.
One of the hostages' relatives told the crowd that humanitarian aid should be cut to Gaza until the Israeli hostages receive aid as well. Others demanded release of the hostages as a condition for a ceasefire. All seem to agree that with the military operation in Gaza, the hostages are in harm's way, and the Israeli government and the rest of the world need to do more to secure their release. Natasha Mozgobaya, VOA News, Tel Aviv, Israel.
The evacuation of Filipinos in Gaza at a standstill amid intensifying attacks there. The first batch of Filipinos was supposed to exit the Strip Sunday, but it is yet to be rescheduled. Only 46 out of the 134 Filipinos in the enclave want to return home. Most of them refuse to leave without their Palestinian spouses.
Our government, through our embassy in Tel Aviv, is making representations, making appeals to the Israeli government to allow the departure of the Palestinian spouses to accompany our Filipino nationals out of Gaza. The message we're conveying to the Israeli government is that it will be difficult to separate families.
Meanwhile, another 22 Filipinos from Israel arrived in the country Monday. The ashes of a Filipino caregiver killed in the war were also brought home. In Ukraine, President Volodymyr Zelensky dismisses as irresponsible any notion of holding an election in wartime. That's amid increased debate at home and abroad about a potential poll in March 2024, although the ongoing martial law prohibits any election. Zelensky now calls on unity to avoid what he called pointless political discussion, ruling out a presidential election in March 2024. He adds it is critical to concentrate on military challenges facing Ukraine as it tries to expel Russian forces occupying nearly one-fifth of its land more than 20 months after the invasion began. Well, Parkinson's patients get a new lease on life with an implant that allows them to regain some control over the disease. Take a look.
Parkinson's disease patient Mark Gutierrez was confined to his house due to debilitating mobility issues. But it all changed after he became the first person to receive a new Swiss-designed implant.
It changed my life because now I can leave my home, run errands. I even go on foot to exercise.
Parkinson's is a degenerative neurological disease that causes symptoms such as tremors, stiffness, and difficulty with balance and coordination. Global estimates showed more than 8.5 million people suffered from the disease in 2019. 63-year-old Gautier received a neuroprosthetic composed of an electrode field placed against his spinal cord, combined with an electrical impulse generator under the skin of his abdomen. The device stimulates his spinal cord to activate his leg muscles. Dr. Grégoire Courtine of the Swiss Federal Institute of Technology in Lausanne co-led the project.
The technology is a nerve stimulator that delivers precise pulses of electricity to the region of the spinal cord involved in the control of leg muscles. And the pulses are delivered at the correct location with the correct timing in order to reproduce the way the spinal cord is activated naturally in order to walk.
Courtine said the electrical pulses delivered to Gautier's spinal cord reproduce the way he would walk naturally. The implant, designed by Netherlands-based tech company called Onward Medical, is unique in its ability to target the spinal cord in a specific and flexible way. The findings suggest the technology could be used more widely in advanced Parkinson's patients. Neurosurgeon Jocelyn Bloch carried out the surgery on Gautier.
With this therapy, if people can gain more confidence and can go out and have a better social interaction and do more things, it's an enormous plus in the daily activity and the quality of life.
Filipino talents help bring to life Netflix's newest animated series, Blue Eye Samurai. Our Hollywood correspondent Yong Chavez tells us more.
Set during the period in Japan when warriors reigned, Blue Eye Samurai tells the story of a sword master in disguise who's out for vengeance.
You have enemies now, rich ones. You can take off those things. We know what they hide. We know who you are. All Kyoto is talking about the unnamed samurai who cut through Shindo Dojo.
I have a name.
No one will ever know it.
Filipino-American actor and martial arts legend Mark Dacascos plays a formidable villain who leads a nefarious group that hunts the lead character Misu, voiced by Maya Erskine.
Mark Dacascos, I have to just say, is one of the, like, for a guy who can kick your ass, is the nicest, kindest man. He knows your name for life. You can see him 35 years from now. And when he's done kicking your ass, he will call you by your first name and help you off the floor.
Film actor Eric Bauza, one of Hollywood's most prominent talents in voice acting, is also in the series playing several characters, including a shady trader named Goro.
Eric Bauza is in every episode somewhere. We always play Spot the Bauza.
The Filipino talents in the cast also include Alain Uy, who plays the Shogun's eldest son. Co-creator and executive producer Amber Nuisumi shares that part of Misu's story as a biracial person mirrored some of her own identity struggles.
Back when I was a child, I was always looking for like anybody who looked like me, anybody who looked similar to me, and that idea that I was less than because of that. And I don't think I admitted it to myself fully at the time or thought it was odd. And it took many years to realize like, oh, I've also been on this journey of self-acceptance. And so, you know, we put Misu on that same journey.
The visually striking series with heavy emotional content is meant for adult viewers and features bloody action scenes and sexuality. The production used filmmaking techniques not usually seen in television and further proves that animation can tell complex stories. Blue Eye Samurai is now streaming on Netflix. Yong Chavez, ABS-CBN News, here in Hollywood.